Now, hilarity moment.
You ever wonder how come they don't make mouse-flavored cat food?
Hello, everybody, wherever you may be, from coast to coast and sea to shining sea. Welcome back to Ham Radio Live, show about radio for people who love radio. Today, a big talk about Greyline. Hope you enjoy it. Welcome back to the show.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray right through the very heart of it. New York, New York. In a city that doesn't sleep, and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap.
Should be a lot of fun today. I'm going to talk about Greyline propagation, how it works, what it does, and where to work it. Yesterday just didn't quite touch enough on it, so I'm grateful you're here. From around the world, wherever you may be, away we go. Hi, everybody. Welcome back to the show. It's an honor to see you today. Very happy Thursday to you from around the world. Thanks for coming to Ham Radio Live. The whole purpose is to help you get into amateur radio. A lot of people love radio, but they just think ham is too hard. And please, don't think that. If I'm capable of getting a ham radio license, believe me, you are as well. Please contact someone out there like the Radio Society of Great Britain, wonderful group at www.rsgb.org. Let them know where you're located. They'll send a ham radio club close to you in an email. Get to know the club. They'll help you get your license, and then you'll learn about ham radio. www.rsgb.org. Great mates there. Today's the big day that the WRMICQ calling show is on, powered by ICOM. I come for the love of ham radio. It heads towards Europe, North Africa, and the Middle East in about 7 minutes on 15770 kilohertz. Then tomorrow you'll get the show as well at 2115 UTC on 7780 kilohertz. North America has a show tonight, 7:30 p.m. Eastern on 9395 kilohertz. A wonderful signal heading towards the West Coast in the evening. So that's good frequency. Caribbean, Central, and South America get the show tonight at 8:15 Eastern on 9955 kilohertz. And that also is going to be simulcast on the internet stream at www.wrmi.net. And it's a great, great show this week. Going to be featuring William Desjardins, Whiskey One Zulu Yankee, talking a little bit about beverage antennas, how you can build one simple. That's going to help you receive better in radio. Okay, first up, we'll say hello. Chris, DX Scotland, very first one in the house. Welcome, mate. It's always good to see you. Happy Thursday night to you all the way in the UK. Man, Scotland, first in. Welcome, Chris. How are you? I hope things are well for you and your family tonight. Thank you for joining us on the show today. Second up, State of Missouri, David, Alpha Echo Zero, Papa Hotel. Hello, my friend. Happy Thursday to you. Will Myers in the cold state of Wisconsin. Kilo Alpha 8 Golf India Mike. Andy Cowley joins us from Great Britain. His call sign 2 Echo Zero Romeo Echo Echo. Kim Cheney is back. Hi, Kim. Brandon Bird, Kentucky is here. Welcome. Kilo Oscar 4, India Papa India. Welcome. Nice to have you, Kim. Thanks for being here. Rod Bish joins us from the state of Pennsylvania. Whiskey 3, Mike Papa Golf. Hello, my friend. Good to see you, Rod, as always. Greg from Bettendorf, Iowa. Hi, Greg. Kilo Fox 0, Charlie Union Zulu. Happy Thursday afternoon to you. My brother Bob, courtesy of WIFI. Hello, Bob. Happy Thursday, buddy. Gary Strong, Las Vegas, Nevada is here. Whiskey 9, Papa Papa Yankee. Hello, Gary. Nice to see you and a very, very happy Thursday. Steve, I did this show especially for you. I really did. Yep. Steve's call sign, Mike 7, India Whiskey Hotel. Steve, I'm grateful you're here, mate, because, you know, when I listened to yesterday's show about Greyline, I just kind of sat there and shook my head because I could have went longer on it, but I couldn't physically go longer. Today's a better day for my back, and I can really dive into Greyline. You had a question about meter bands and which ones work better. Today, we'll talk about that, and we'll go into some detail about Greyline because it's a very special time. Each day happens, you know, sunrise and sunset. And you can make calls halfway around the world. It's amazing. And you don't have to have 100 watts to do it. So, Steve, I'm grateful you're back. Hello, Kevin. Welcome back. State of Iowa is here. Hi, Kev. Kilo Zero, Kilo Lima Bravo. Great YouTube channel. He really is very ingenious. Kevin, thank you for about the like button. I appreciate that. I just kind of do this as a radio show. You know, and radio shows, you don't ask for like buttons or subscriptions. The subscription count is what it is. And for me personally, I never look at it. I'm probably the only person on YouTube that just doesn't care. I care about people coming and enjoying the show. That's it. So if you're here and you like it, that makes me pretty happy. Thanks, Kev. Good to see you. Scott, state of Colorado is here. Hi, Scott. Good afternoon to you there in the beautiful state of Colorado. From the German frontier, that's our friend Gunter, DK5ONV. Welcome, my friend. Good to see you. Thanks for coming today. Nice to have you this evening in Germany. Man, long time. Mark Cope. Hello, Mark. He's my DX mate. And we're going to do a medium wave DX show. We will. And it's going to be fun because I'll be able to tell you hopefully what frequencies most of the frequency sweeps are. And keep in mind, it's from the northwest of the United States. So we're limited a lot by the Rocky Mountains, really are. We can hear KOA Denver from here, but that's about it. We usually don't get too much farther east than that. People in the Midwest, you're spoiled. Same with people in the Rockies. You get both ways there. But yeah, we'll do a show on AMDX. So I'm grateful you're here. Mark says, I heard you CQ calling 9955 last night, listening on a web SDR in Colombia. Sounded great. Thanks, Mark. Thank you. That's pretty cool. Man, hey, nice. That's pretty good. That's good. And Chris is at his son's football training again tonight. I hope it goes well. I hope everything goes well for your son. And he does well tonight. Paul Hastings, hello from Florida. He says, and it's cold. Oh, no. Kilo Quebec 4, Charlie Delta. You know, we've been watching that, too, Paul. We really have been because that world, you know, webcam thing. Anyway, we watch out of Winter Gardens, and, man, it's been really cold in Florida. Very cold for you guys. I bet they've got the citrus crops being warmed up quite a bit down there. So, yeah, cold air really dipping into the state of Florida, past the panhandle. It's going deep into Florida right now. My friend Tom Bahrain is here. Hello, Tom. Alpha 92 Golf Whiskey. Happy Thursday evening to you, and thank you for coming. What a good group today. This is a good group. Andy. Hi, Andy. November Yankee 5 Echo. That means Ocala, Florida is here. Central Florida, Florida is here. Hello, my friend, and a very happy Thursday afternoon to you there. Let's see. First time live with Paul. That's first time. That's applause. Thank you, Paul. Thank you. I just realized I didn't bring my water. Oh, no. Oh, no. Not good. Look at that. Brand new. This is a first timer. Enkido. Enkido, hello from Egypt. Hello to you. What an honor. Wow. Thanks for coming. Really, from Egypt. Welcome. Welcome to Ham Radio Live. It's a show about radio. Put in the comment sections your questions, your comments. We're grateful you're here. You're now part of the show and part of the family. Welcome. We have Holland here. Hello, Anton. Papa Charlie 4 Alpha Delta. Welcome. Andy New is here from the UK. Mike 7. Charlie Union November. And let's get this show on the road. Folks, if you'd like to email the show, maybe have a question or suggestion, please feel free and reach me at cqhamradiolive@gmail.com. The guest coming this Saturday, great guest, talk about working digital modes like FT8. Brad Humphreys joins us. From Canada, Alpha Echo 4, Victor Juliet, going to learn about working FT8. This is a great and very popular digital mode that's really caught on, especially with younger hams. Really popular. So if you'd like to learn how to do it, please join us. 20 UTC. If you're in the UK, that's 8 p.m. Western Europe, 9. Eastern Europe, 10 p.m. If you're here in the States, that's 3 p.m. in the East and noon Pacific. Over in Australia, you're on Sydney, maybe Melbourne side. That'll be at 7 a.m. on Sunday. Please join us for Brad Humphreys. The following Saturday will be Charlie from Red Summit RF. He's going to talk to us about how to work portable in the year 2022. Grateful that Charlie's going to be here. November Juliet 7 Victor. The following Saturday, Jeff Doran, November Juliet 2 Union Sierra, has a nice YouTube channel here. He'll be answering your questions regarding beverage receive antennas. That's going to be on Saturday, the 19th of February at 20 UTC. Then the following Saturday, my friend Tom Polyard, right here from Bahrain, Alpha 92 Golf Whiskey, going to teach us how to use a very affordable adjustable whip antenna to make transcontinental contacts with. He's great at it. Tom is really brilliant at this. And he's such a smart guy. He really is. And he's going to talk about how you can use this antenna and make great calls. Best part, it's under $100 shipped. Then new news, here it is. The Smokin' Ape joins us Saturday, March 5th at 20 UTC. We're going to talk about antennas, so please join us. Meet the Ape, and we'll talk about antennas, and we'll talk about his YouTube channel. A lot of fun with Smokin' Ape coming up on March the 5th. We have a question for you today on the show. Today's question, what's the longest call you've ever made? And this is a really important question for this show. Because we're going to cover Greyline in detail today, this is where long calls can be made. Halfway around the world calls, okay? Now, it depends on propagation, and a lot of it depends on the seasons, too. We'll get into that in just a moment, okay? But what's the longest call you ever made? Put it in the comment section, and it will be part of the show. I want to welcome Cliff Bolt, State of Virginia, Whiskey Delta 4, Oscar Bravo Papa. Cliff, welcome. It's great to have you. You know, yesterday, I told you I'd play the Muppet critics. Remember, it's Waldorf and Stanton was their names on the Muppet show. They set up in the crow's nest. They gave the Muppets all, you know, heck all the time. We thought of them like the angry hams, right? We've all heard the angry hams on ham radio. Now, you know, it's true, haven't we? We've always heard them, right? Oh, water. Excellent. Okay, so we've always heard them before. So we're going to put a little segment about some angry hams. We're going to dedicate to them, actually, a little bit of the show. So here we go, the angry hams little bit for the show on Ham Radio Live 379. Here you go.
Misery.
No. We got to get better than that. Here we go, the whole clip.
Let's put this show out of its misery.
There you go. Okay. Here's the weather powered by ICOM. ICOM for the love of ham radio. Love the Muppets. Oh, gosh. Love the Muppets. The A1A looks good. We've got two rings of sunspots, and that is really good for us right now. It really is. Backside of the sun, we still have three active sunspot regions that have survived. Hopefully, they'll come to the front of the sun soon. 29, 34, 35, and 36 are there. Here's a coronal hole map. 47 is here, and it is affecting a little bit of our propagation. Last 3 days of our solar activity, no big solar flares. That's good. Noise floors down, which is great. K2 now, that's quiet, so you should have good conditions on the lower bands today. Current conditions out of Boulder, SFI 102, solar number is 71, A index is a little bit high at 10, your K index is 2, BZ latitude, again, minus 2.9 degrees, and our solar wind, 450.5 kilometers per second. So negative BZ latitude means might have some QSB and maybe a little bit of propagation issues today, you know, all throughout the HF bands, but you can make great calls today, too. EME degree is good, and there is your HF conditions. I think we probably squeezed 12 today, and some 10 as well. I'm looking at 10, and there's some weak signals there. MUFs, current, Alaska 16.88, Boulder 23.57. If you go to Ascension Island, look at that, 46.68 megahertz. That's insane. Hermana, South Africa is at 18.61. Athens, Greece at 20.7. Knife Island in the Far East is at 23.79. Darwin, Australia says 29.51. I don't buy it. Here's the reason why. Kilo Charlie 2 golf map. And this is what it looks like out of Australia. Currently about 17 megahertz, really near Darwin. If you're towards Melbourne, more about 13 megahertz, but take a look there. Both 18 megahertz and 21 are real close to Australia. So within the hour, you should be on 15 meters. If you're in North America, you're running anywhere from about, you can run 20 to 10 meters, depending upon where you're at in the country. I've seen 28 pop up a couple times this morning. Alaska, you're on 20 meters and heading towards 17. If you're in South America, you pretty much get everything. You can run everything from 20 to 10 right now. Same with Africa. Mid-latitudes have great conditions. Your ham and shortwave forecast for today, powered by ICOM. ICOM for the love of ham radio. Daytime ham bands open for voice should be 20, 17, 15, 12, and some 10-meter openings in the northern hemisphere. Equatorial latitudes, 20, 17, 15, 12, and 10. That's the same for the south. You'll get 20, 17, 15, 12, and 10. CB radio skip in the north should have some short openings today. 11 meters should be wide open in the mid and south latitudes for some DX. Data should work fine for you, though. 30 to 10 meters in all latitudes. Your nighttime ham band should be 160, 80, 75, 60, 40, 30. Best EX is on 40 in the north, 20 in the south. But remember, 20 and 17 will work brilliantly at Greyline. We'll talk about that. And you might even get some 12 and 15 meters Greyline tonight, too. Shortwave bands today, 31, 25, 22, and 19. Shortwave nighttime, 120, 90, 75, 60, 49, 41, 31, 25, 22. And the 19-meter band will work great in the south hemisphere about 90 minutes after sunset. Then the signals will simply fade away. But good conditions today, really are. We don't have bad radio conditions. In fact, 10 meters has a little bit of openings right now in the north. But really, most of your activity is probably going to be focused 12 to 20. That's the way it should be today. All right? Let's take a look at your questions. Today's question, your answers to today's question. What's the longest call you've ever made? We'll catch up with you, and we'll add it to the show. All right? First one up. Let's get, let me see if we can get somebody here very first. Let's see. Hey, look at this. Outback Traveler, very first timer. Welcome to the show. Nice to have you. First timer. Thanks for coming. Good day. This is Victor Kilo 2 X-Ray Bravo, mobile in the outback of Australia in a multi-combo trailer big truck. I'll be listening but won't be commenting as I am listening rather than viewing as such. Well, this is supposed to be a soundtrack about radio. It's true. So we're grateful you're a part of the show. Thanks for coming, mate. Thank you. Good day to you. Good day to you. His name is Indy. That's great. In the outback of Australia. Man, I'd love to be with you. I would. I'd love to be with you. Man, I'd love to be there. That'd be fun. Steve in the UK, his call sign, Mike 7, India Whiskey Hotel, longest 5-watt FT8 to Brazil during Greyline. Yep. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Anton in Holland, Statler and Waldorf can usually be found at 160 meters. I may argue with you and say it's going to be on 80, but yeah, you're pretty darn close. Dave Lauricia, continent number 5 already. My goodness, I'm honored. Thanks, Dave. In Argentina, it is used on 80-meter band to repeat 3 times when you're calling. Very good. David, thank you for your comment, and thanks again for coming today. It's great to have you here. It really is. Oh, let's see. Adam from Ocala, Florida, longest call, Fox Romeo 4 Kilo Romeo, Reunion Island. 9,750 miles away from his QTH in North Central Florida. That's a big call right there. Adam, nice call. Beautiful. Beautiful. And Gunter, thank you for your kind words. Always enjoy this show. Thank you. I'm grateful you're here today. Thank you. Chris in Scotland, best I think was Fiji on 40 meters in 1990. Now think about that. From Scotland to Fiji. That's a long way. That's a very long well. Nice call, Chris. Nice call. Sean, 2 Echo 0 X-Ray Bravo Tango, welcome to the show. He says, best long DX for me. I was mobile and put a call out on a station on 20 meters. I made that contact, 5-4 to VK7, Romeo Oscar Yankee. That's a VK7. Okay, that's Tasmania. Okay, that's even south of Australia. Roy and I are now friends and message regularly. Best ever. That's great, Sean. What a nice comment. That might be the comment of the show. Yeah, because he made a friend out of it. That's awesome. That really is. Kevin in Iowa, longest call QRP sideband 1 watt to Hungary using MFJ 1979 antenna during a POTA activation. That's stunning. Wow. That's stunning. I know we're playing applause a lot, but these are accomplishments. Wow. Holy cow. Sean wants to add also 2 Echo 0 X-ray Bravo Tango also worked VP/LP Bob in the Falklands. Wow. Static mobile on 15 meters by parked on the beach. And that's a really good place to be. On the beach, everything changes. He also adds great contact as also just 10 watts as I was foundation, Mike 6 Sierra Kilo Papa. When you go to the beach with your rig, if you can make it to the ocean, everything changes because the horizon changes, right? You don't have mountains and trees and all those things in your way. It's a clear path. And when Rod and I worked field day this past summer, it really was pronounced. We were hearing, you know, Kilo 6 H's a lot from Hawaii, which we normally may not hear if we were in the valley here because the mountain, the coastal range here in Oregon would block that signal. But when you get to the ocean, everything's wide open. That's a great comment. Thank you very much, Sean. That's good. Mike in Jacksonville, welcome to the show. Kilo Delta 2, Sierra X-Ray Delta, good afternoon to you, mate. Good to see you. Will Myers in Wisconsin, longest for me is an FT8 into Ukraine. about 4,800 miles. Wow. Not that far, I know, but my hex beam is still sitting on the ground. Think about that. You've got a directional antenna on the ground, and you make almost a 5,000-mile contact into Ukraine. That's fantastic. William, great comment. Thank you for adding that to it. Tom says, nice one, Sean. Last week was listening to a station in VK7, but could not give me a call. It was not his frequency. That can be frustrating, right? When you're listening and you hear a really good DX call to a pileup, right? And then you're like, oh, I'd love to make that call, right? But you can't because it's somebody else's frequency. Nice comment, Tom. That can be very frustrating in ham radio for sure. Rod out of Pennsylvania, longest call on my knees. Yep, true. Hey, Tim, welcome. Tim, Golf 5 Tango Mike, great YouTube channel here. Thank you, Tim. You honor me by coming. Happy Thursday night, mate. It's great to see you. How's everything going for you? Is it good? I hope things are good. It's wonderful when you come. Thank you. Tim says, my best long DX is to ZL, which is, of course, New Zealand. On 40 meters with a 94-foot doublet, been around my garden about 20 feet above ground. So let's imagine England all the way down to New Zealand. That's about as far as they go from England. That's a great call, Tim. Congratulations on a wonderful call to ZL. Wow. Beautiful. Daniel from New Hampshire joined us. Hi, Dan. Argentina on FT8, 5,415 miles. Canary Islands on SSB, 3182. That's a great call for you, man. Congratulations. I made Canary Islands one time, and the guy didn't confirm. I was like, ah, terrible. Anton in Holland, my longest contact was with Japan Hotel 3, November Golf Delta on 40 meters, was also not short in time duration with multiple overs, lasts about 15 minutes. Those are the best calls ever, aren't they, Anton? When you make a call that's like with a friend, right? You get a chance to communicate for a little while. That's the beauty of ham radio. And that's why if you're not a ham, it's the difference between shortwave DX and medium wave DX and ham radio. And you can pass your test. You can. Don't keep thinking about it. The solar cycle is coming up. It takes about 11 years for the peak every time. You don't wait any longer now. If you don't have a license, start studying for it. You can definitely pass it. I'm living proof of that. Seriously, don't wait on that, okay? Gunter in Germany, my longest contact portable were China and New Zealand. That's phenomenal for portable. Well done. Well done, Gunter. Tim, Golf 5 Tango Mike, my favorite ever contact was on 10 meters to the States in 2017, 10 watts and a hamstick after dark to November 8, India. That's cool, man. You know, mate, when you go and you go by the beach or the shore and you've got a hamstick and that's a marginal antenna. It's not perfect. But then you make a great call with it. You're like, wow, that was awesome. That really worked out well. Nice call. Thank you. Kel is here from Norway. Lima Bravo Zero, Yankee India, a bit late, he says. Anyway, hello all. Welcome to the show. It's nice to have you here. Don Bush, my friend in Afton, New York. Welcome, Don. Larry, Brother Bob, always my best to all on board today. Whiskey Alpha 2, Tango Papa Uniform Slant QRP. Welcome. It's nice to see you. Tom says, not the longest, but always a Wahoo moment when I get into Maine. Longest would be either Washington State or Alaska. Now, keep in mind, he's in Bahrain in the Middle East, so he's got to go over the pole to try and get us over here on the West Coast. It's a tough call. Now, with the directional, it changes everything, but he's using a vertical. So, Tom, that's great. And I know you've made a call to Alaska. Yes, you have. Yes, you have. Andy New, 20 miles to Wells, Somerset on a repeater. Oh, that's okay. It's a call. It's a call. That's a good thing. I'm good. And Tim, thank you. I'm well, and I'm really honored you're here. Thank you. For folks that don't know Tim is a really good YouTube channel, a wonderful YouTube channel that you can learn so much about ham radio with. You really can. So I encourage you, if you haven't seen it yet, please go to Golf 5 Tango Mike here on YouTube and subscribe. You're going to learn a lot of stuff from Tim. He's very talented at what he does. Color Me OD, welcome back from Canada. Hello, friends. Larry, my song of the day is Glenn Frey's The Heat Is On. The furnace is fixed. Good. I prayed about that. I did. My wife came home sick yesterday. She wasn't feeling good. And I told her about your problem. She's like, oh, no. He was like minus 40 Celsius and his furnace went out. Oh, man. That would be awful. Tim Dixon, first timer and welcome. What an honor to have you. Thank you for coming, Tim. Happy Thursday. He says, I've had Argentina, South Africa, Portugal, Spain, and Western Sahara from Utah on sideband. Fantastic work, Tim. Wow. I'm just looking at all these countries. Look at that. That's fantastic. Tim, thanks for sharing. That's maybe the comment of the show. Wow. VK Radio Ham, welcome. That's call sign Victor Kilo 3, Golf Echo Kilo. That's con number 5. Thanks for being here, mate. Good to see you. It's good to see you. Let's see. Don Bush, here we go. And this one is on YouTube, by the way. 1 watt to Zed Sierra 1, Romeo Juliet, Quebec, and Zed Sierra 1, Papa Zulu in South Africa. He really did it. Yeah. Now, understand, at first he was at, I think, 5 or 10, but then they did an experiment. Okay, you can find it here on YouTube. Just search Whiskey Alpha 2, Tango Papa Uniform. All you have to do. You'll find his video. And what they do is they turn down the wattage on all their transceivers. All three of them did. And they're literally making 1 watt transmissions. They did it. 1 watt. That's a long ways. Well done, Don. Yeah, well done. Well done. And Gunter, yeah, Tim is a great channel. You'll learn so much. Tim is really, really gifted. He really, really is. Let's get into a couple trivia questions, Dan. The show first one. Think about it. How many U.S. call sign districts border the Great Lakes? Okay, now let's think about this. You got Lake Superior, Lake Michigan. You got Lake Erie, okay, Lake Ontario. Okay, so you've got multiple lakes. How many call districts in the U.S. border them? Is it A2, B3, C4, or D5? Let me know with A, B, C, or D. It's currently 85-80. The world leads North America, but it is razor thin close. Really is razor thin right now. So how many call signs in the U.S. border the Great Lakes? A2, B3, C4, or D5? Let me know, and we will let you know who gets it right today, all right, on the show. It's good to have you as part of Ham Radio Live this Thursday. Thanks for coming. First one in on the trivia question from Ocala, Florida. It is Adam, November Yankee 5 Echo. He says the answer is 5. And Tim, you would be correct. Well done. I said Tim, Adam, sorry. It's perfect. Yeah, it is 5. There's five call districts that connect. Here's the map, okay? Here's where you could get messed up. You really could, okay? You got call district 2, which is New York. That's Lake Erie, okay? You also have Pennsylvania, Lake Erie. You also have the 8th call district. So 2 is New York, 3 is Pennsylvania. 8 is Ohio and Michigan. So there's the third one, okay? Call district 9, Indiana, Illinois, and Wisconsin border Lake Michigan and part of Wisconsin, Lake Superior. But then you go into call district 0. Minnesota connects with Lake Superior. So that's why it is. It's 0, 9, 8, 3, and 2. Congratulations to Adam for getting right. It's a tie game now. Daniel on this one had B. Will Myers had B. Sean was C. Cliff had C. Steve had C. Color Me OD had D. Rod in Pennsylvania had D. We had Tim with C. Andy New had B. And my dear friend Gunter in Germany, C. Chris had C. And there you go. Yeah, Minnesota can kind of throw you a little bit there because just the northern tip can do that to you. All right. We go into question number 2. Before we do that, let's catch up with your comments. A lot of folks here today, and I do want to thank you for coming. I sincerely mean that. Okay. First up, let's see. Let's go to Daniel. If you're supremely lucky, you can hit faraway repeaters with FM. By some quirk of geography, I have a straight line to a repeater in Western Massachusetts, 150 miles away. Absolutely. And if you have an antenna, VHF, UHF antenna with a lot of gain to it, it makes a big difference. Also, elevation. Huge difference for VHF, UHF. No question about that. Shannon Eastep, my longest was to Australia from East Tennessee on 100 watts in a wire. He's using an IC718 and an NFED half wave. Shannon, nice call. Well done, mate. That's great. That's really good. Yeah. Greg Boggs joins us from the state of North Carolina. Welcome, Greg. Tim Dixon, not first time, though. We talked earlier on the channel, former Marshall, Missouri native, and those contacts all done with a vertical DX Commander antenna. Well done, sir. Well done. Tim, Golf 5 Tango Mike, a lift on 2 meters is also great fun. Hearing repeaters 150, 200 miles away. Yep. Once you get elevation, it changes everything. It's different with VHF, UHF, right? If you're on HF and you go to the coast, it changes the world because now all of a sudden there's nothing on the horizon to block your signal. You're going to hear everything that direction. But if you're on VHF, UHF, you add elevation, now you're hearing, you're hitting repeaters from a long ways away. Nice comment, Tim. Yep, exactly. Let me get back up here and catch up with all of you guys here. Hold on a second. There's a lot of people here today. Wow, thank you. All right, Outback Traveler 58. I've actually got a point of view clip on my channel when I was heading home from holiday between Christmas and New Year to France in my car, mobile in the middle of the hay plains, 40 meters. I'd love to see it. Send it to me, will you? Please. Yeah, cqamradiolive@gmail.com. And it's part of the beginning of the show. So just email me there. That I'd love to show it. That'd be fun to do. All right. Let's get to trivia question number 2 today on a Thursday. Here it is. Now think carefully on this. UK amateurs are allowed to use aeronautical mobile or / AM on the end of their call signs. Is that true or false? True or false? UK amateurs are allowed to use slant AM, which means aeronautical mobile. That's your clue. On the end of their call signs. A, true. B, false. Currently, tie score 85-85. Let's see who wins. Outback Traveler 58. I always talk from the truck into your country, kind of multiple times, using a Terlin multi-tap antenna. Always mobile and about 70 watts. Back on the road he goes. Thank you for joining us today on the show. It's an honor to have you. All right. In the UK, think about this. Can you use aeronautical mobile? Chris, first up, with A, true. No. Daniel, New Hampshire, B, false. He is correct. You, man, you did it. North America finally takes the lead, 90-85. Now, this is a trick question, okay? And the reason why it's a trick question is because in the UK, you're not allowed to transmit on ham radio from an airplane. You can't. That's part of the rules. So you can't use aeronautical mobile because you can't be on an airplane and use a ham radio. That's the whole point. So that's why the answer is false. It's against the rules in the UK. Yeah, let's take a look at the rest of your answers real quick, okay? Anton had B. Will had B. So did Adam in California. Sean had D. Steve in the UK had B. Shannon had D. Cliff Engel, welcome to the show. It's a first-timer. Welcome. Whiskey 3, Kilo Kilo India. He had B. Andy knew had B. Tim had B. He knew that. Rich Torgerson, A though is not required. Well, yeah, you can't actually transmit there from an airplane. It's true. Don Bush, my best and longest contact on 2 meters was to Alaska. Wow. During a tropospheric duck by SSB. Yeah, that's a great duck, mate. You hit it good. Chris in Scotland. Ooh, I better stop doing it then. Now, don't do it from an airplane, Chris.
No.
Not a good idea. All right. We're going to talk today, and I'll get to your comments, about something I really, really, really wanted to cover. Okay? And I did a little bit of it yesterday. It was on Greyline. And Greyline is a magical time for hams. And I promise I'll get to your comments. But this is really important because it'll help people. And when Steve last night, or yesterday, I should say, asked the question about, is there a certain meter band that would work better than others during the daytime, you know, during Greyline, what would it be? And Steve, after, you know, looking at your comment and listening to my reply, I was not happy. So we're going to redo that segment, but with some detail. All right. First, let's talk about what Greyline looks like if we were to have a visual view way above the earth with really crummy drawings. Okay. All right. During the day, the earth is like this. Okay. Remember, and it starts really with MUF, and that's why MUF is up here. Maximum usable frequency is huge. Okay. Now keep in mind, I want to preface this talk with one thing. There is a big difference between shortwave broadcasting and hams. total difference. And the reason why is because shortwave can use directional antennas and tons of power. Okay, so they can be heard. You can hear shortwave at Greyline from different locations at certain times of day. Greyline, similar to ham, very similar, but they're using a completely different transmitting system. For hams, it's very different. During the daytime, the maximum usable frequency makes a huge difference. It really does, because it depends on where you're at in the world and where you match it. That's important. During the day, remember, we have four layers of the ionosphere, D, E, F1, and F2, all right? The D layer is going to absorb signals or attenuate them, okay, about 10 megahertz down. That's what it does. Now, during the nighttime, the D layer disappears completely, and that's the magic of Greyline. This is where it really gets interesting, okay? You still have on this side of the sun, this side of the earth, I mean on the dark side, you get a modified E layer, which is weaker, far weaker, and then the F2 and F1 regions form one thick region about 250 kilometers up. So that's where our signals go. Okay. Remember two things about this talk. The D layer disappears. So remember, if you're trying to take a ham exam that goes higher in class, remember at night, D layer disappears. D layer attenuates lower frequency signals 10 megahertz down. Okay. The nighttime side has no D layer. That's why 40 and 80 meters work so good at night and make great calls. They really do. But the D layer is gone, okay? The E and the F layer are still there. F is really supercharged, but it's timing. Remember, you're talking sunrise to, you know, the beginning of the light coming, and then the sun comes up, and then it goes up higher, okay? What's the first part of the ionosphere to get charged? It's always going to be the F layer because it's highest, okay? So as the sun comes up, the F layer starts to get radiation from the sun and it starts to get more ionization, okay? Then the D layer starts to get more ionization. You see what I'm going with this? That your calls all of a sudden go farther, because when your calls go up to the ionosphere, hit the ground and go back up, you lose a minimum of 3 dB. You do, a minimum of 3 decibels every time. So every earth hop, you lose about 3 dB of attenuation. Now, during the night, you don't have that so much because literally your signals on the nighttime side are going way up and way down. But at Greyline, things change because the ionization of the atmosphere is changing. Let's take a look at some visuals here to give you an idea. All right, here are your layers of the ionosphere. And we'll talk a little bit about equatorial as well, because it's important. Because when we have Greyline, it's not a perfect circle. It's actually more elliptical, okay? During nights, all year long, the E layer at night is going to be about 100 kilometers. The F layer, about 300 kilometers, okay? During the night in the winter, the D layer is below 100 kilometers. E runs right about 100 kilometers. F1 and F2 start about 225 kilometers to about 350 kilometers, okay? But in the summer, the D layer is still about 100 or so. The E layer comes, sorry, D about 70, 75. And then the E layer pops in right about 85 to 100, really. Then the F layer comes in about 175 in miles, and the F2 layer right about 275 miles up. That's the way it is in the summer. So things change depending upon the time of year. Why? Because there's less sunlight. That's why, because the sun isn't shining as much to charge up the ionosphere. So that's why the layers change in height from winter to summer. Your best time of year to wear Greyline for that reason is going to be during the fall and during the spring. That's when everything's equal and you can make really good calls, really can. Here's the layers of the ionosphere and how they work. During the daytime, you have the D layer. Again, it'll attenuate everything about 10 megahertz down. You can still make calls. Don't get me wrong. You can certainly make calls, but the Greyline affects them. Let's take a look at the D. Here's the D layer. Let's play 40 meters. Okay, you're on 7 megahertz, 7.1. Okay, during the daytime, your signal goes maybe, I don't know, let's say 500-600 miles. Okay, but at night, there's no D layer. So it goes to the E layer and goes much farther because the D layer attenuates the frequencies of 10 megahertz down. That's why 40 doesn't go so far at night. I'm sorry, during the daytime, pardon me. Now, we can talk about critical angle and all of that stuff, but we're going to stick with Greyline on this conversation, okay? The ionosphere will refract your signals. They don't reflect them, they refract them, okay? They come up the ionosphere, hit the Earth, and they lose about 3 dB, come back up, and then hopefully hit a transmitter, or you can have multi-hop. But remember, 3 dB is about what you're going to lose. Here's why the equator is different, okay? You see how the F layer goes way up around the middle part of the Earth? That's why. That's why if you're on the the equatorial latitudes, man, you can make some amazing calls, and they stay up in the ionosphere because you've got a longer F layer. It's farther out there along the equator, right around Greyline. So it's not a perfect circle. It does change when the sun goes down and when the sun comes up. Okay. Here's a good illustration from Papa Yankee 4 Foxtrot Tango Lima, daytime, nighttime. Okay. Your daytime, you take a look and then you look at where Greyline hits. Okay. Say your signal comes from Papa Alpha 9X. Okay. Your signal, remember, if you've got a vertical antenna, you're going all directions. Okay. So you're going, he goes up and down, up and down, and hits VK6 Zulu Quebec Zulu. Okay. So that's a two skip refraction. All right. So he's lost 3 dB from that, but he still makes the call. But then take a look at the other side. Because he's close to nighttime, all right, the call goes up to the ionosphere, hits the Earth one time, and then it stays up in the ionosphere. That's chordal hop. Then it comes back down the long path to VK2 Zulu Quebec Zulu. That's what Greyline does. Because if your signal is going omnidirectional and you're close to day and night, meaning close to sunrise, sunset, you're going to be able to work Greyline. It's a huge impact, just huge, because the actual Greyline looks more like this. You've got a time frame of about 20 to 30 minutes between when the sun comes up and when the sun is up, okay? Your radio loves to work the ionosphere if it's HF. It loves to. But think about this. If you're to the west, okay? Let's say, for example, you're in England, okay? And the sun is starting to go down. You're going to work 20 meters, 17, 15, 12, or 10, if the conditions permit, based on MUF, okay? Why? Because people to the west of you, where it's daylight, are on those frequencies. And your signal has a chance to go up because of Greyline, hit the chordal hop, and then come down in the U.S. and make amazing calls. It's true. That's how you can make calls around the world, literally halfway, no problem. 100 watts, 50 watts, 1 watt. You can do it if conditions permit. During the daytime, as the sun goes down, work west, because west is where the daytime frequencies are being used. Now, what about the opposite? What about if you go the other way? Because remember, it's an omnidirectional antenna, right? Okay. Remember, as you go into darkness, right, you go to, let's say, 20 meters, and you're in England, and you're trying to maybe, I don't know, you hope to hit somebody in India, all right? Just let's say, for example, it's already dark in India, okay? Unless you're using a directional, they're not going to hear you because it's already past Greyline, and the MUF has come down. That's why the MUF is key. When we look at our stats here on the show, when we talk about the weather, right? I show you this map and take a look at the differences. Okay. In Boulder, 23.57. All right. But look at Athens. Athens is 20.7. That's a difference of about 3 kilohertz. Okay. So the people in Athens would not be able to work Boulder, for example, on the 15 meter band. They couldn't. But people in Boulder are really having a ball at 15 meters. So MUF is big. It makes a huge impact. Okay. Knife Island shows 23.79. Boulder shows 23.57. That's a doable call. You see how similar they are? The MUFs make a gigantic impact. They really do. But again, you're talking about where it's day, where it's night. Okay. In the morning, when it's still dark before you have the sun come up. Where are signals coming from? If you're on 40 meters, your signal's coming pretty much from everywhere. But there's a time where on 40 meters, it starts to go short to the east of you. And why is that? Because the sun's up. The D layer has started to form. And what does it attenuate? 40 meters. So you're not going to make great calls going east. But to the west, where it's still dark, you're going to make amazing calls. You really will. And at sunrise, okay, the D layer hasn't formed yet. The first layer to get the ionosphere charged is going to be at the top. That's the F layer. It's where the first sunlight hits, right? Then the E layer gets charged. Finally, the D layer gets charged, okay? This is at sunrise, all right? So if you're on 20 meters, for example, right at Greyline, when the sun is coming up, you might think, well, why can't I work Greyline that way? If the MUF at your location permits 14 megahertz plus, you can take a look at your MUF, all right? But most of the time, you're going to work a band where people to the west of you are. Most of the time, not all the time. It depends on MUFs. If when we get to the top of the solar cycle, right, and things are rocking on 10, you can make calls on 10 meters, you know, half the night and have a ball with your ham radio. But we're talking Greyline. And Greyline exists simply as a time when you can make amazing calls if you catch it and transmit with a decent angle to the ionosphere. Remember how everything charges. F first, because it gets the first sunlight. E next, D last. And D absorbs signals. It attenuates everything 10 megahertz down. At sunset, you already still have a D layer there. Okay? The D layer is still there. That's why you're not going to work 40 yet. Okay? The E layer and F layer are there, though, right? So as the sun is starting to go down where you're at, the D layer is still there. Transmit on a daytime frequency. It will. That's where you want to go. Daytime frequency. Because if you try and transmit on 40, say for example, you're not going to get out very far to the west of you because it's still daylight there and the D layer is absorbing signals. It's attenuating them. So try and remember how it works. Usually west, okay? Except for shortwave, because shortwave uses lots of power and directional beams. Makes a big difference. But in ham talk, we talk about quartal hop and catching the wave. That is when you use Greyline. You can make calls halfway around the world, but the D layer does make a huge difference. Daytime frequencies, you can go anywhere to 10 megahertz. Literally, you can run, to the 10 meter band. You could be on 29 megahertz and make great calls at Greyline if permission, you know, if the conditions exist for MUFs. Follow your MUF map, okay, right around Greyline, and watch what happens. You'll be stunned at the results, okay? I hope that helps. And I'll answer questions regarding this. This is something I've done now for 50 years. No kidding. I've DX'd for a long time. And I got into Greyline study probably about 1980 when I was first really introduced into radio broadcasting. It's something I do understand. The D layer is a huge difference, and it does exist on the daytime side, and it does take a while for it to go away as the sun's going down, okay? That's why you're trying to be on daytime frequencies. Hope that makes sense to you, okay? I didn't want to go too long on it, but I did want to try and help because what Steve asked yesterday was really important. And Steve, you can run all the way to 10 meters if permissions exist. Again, watch your MUF. That's the big key here, because if MUFs are at, say, 18 megahertz, right, and you're trying to pick up somebody on 21, you're not going to get them because you're only at 18 megs. Follow your MUFs and watch what happens around the world. You'll be stunned at the calls that you make. Okay, I hope that helps you, and I hope that that was a segment that hopefully will be understandable. If you don't, please ask me. I'm not an expert, but I do know a lot about this, okay? And I think that's the most water I've ever needed doing this show, to be honest. No kidding. Okay. Let's catch up with your comments. And boy, we got lots of people still answering this question. Let's see what we got for answers here. Or just talk. We'll see. And I thank you for being here. I truly do mean that. Let's see here. Okay. Anton in Holland. 2 meters could be fun indeed. Once had a QSO with a German repeater with a Scottish operating. Really? You caught a German repeater? Yep. Height, right? You had to be somewhere high because to hit it, that'd be hard to do from Holland where you're below sea level. But man, if you did it, that's amazing. It really is. All right, let me catch up with everybody, and hopefully we can answer any questions. Tom in Bahrain, I once worked a commercial airliner over Spain while in LZ on 20 meters on a Sunday morning a few years back. Yeah, that's fun when you work an airplane, right? It's cool. We have a ham that watches this show, and he's an airline co-pilot, right? And so sometimes when they're on long flights, he'll turn the radio on and try and make calls, and people love doing that with him. He says his show, I mean, his flight is a lot better when he can turn the radio on. That's pretty cool. Yeah, it is, old preach. It's kind of like the old KLOS shirt. You're true. Yeah. WPLJ and KLOS were owned by the same company. That's right. It has the same logo. Yeah, true. Andy, welcome. Alpha Alpha Zero, Whiskey X-Ray / Maritime Mobile onboard CQ. Thanks for coming, Andy. Hope you have a pleasant trip. Thank you. And Steve, thank you. If you have any questions, please let me know, okay? I'm not perfect at anything, but one thing I do understand is DX, and I know about Greyline because I've done it for so long. Remember, the D layer and MUF are the two most important components, okay? Remember, D starts to build after sunrise. It goes away after sunset, and that'll help you because, remember, anything under 10 megahertz is attenuated by the D layer, so that'll hopefully help you. Don, you just explained it perfectly, superbly. Thank you, Don. That means a lot. Thank you very, very much. That was something really, really important to me to do. Because, you know, I try to do shows. I don't think I've ever explained this to you folks. I try and do shows that really honor a lot of people in ham radio who do YouTube. I do that purposely. The reason why I do it is because a lot of other people are really, really good at teaching ham radio. And it's good to share that information with you because they're good at what they do. That's where you get the segments towards the three-quarter wave part of the show. But this was one I really wanted to cover myself because it's not that it hasn't been covered. It's just I think that I wanted to cover it in a way hopefully I could take some questions and make it hopefully understandable. I hope that helped. And Steve, thank you. Thank you very much. Thomas Jen, can you provide a link to the MUF map? Yes, absolutely. I will in the description section. I'll give you two. Okay, there'll be one will be the Kilo Charlie 2 golf map, and one will be one that's used on QRZ. It's from November Zero Mike Whiskey Hotel, I think. But it's really good, and it'll help you understand a little bit more about MUFs in different areas. Work the MUF. It's so important in ham radio. If you can work matching MUFs, you're going to get great Greyline propagation. You really will. It really is a huge deal. Anton, just the normal height on both sides. Really? Your repeater might have been high, couldn't hear each other directly. Yeah, well, that would make a difference if you're, like, say, for example, they have a repeater on way up high in a mountaintop, and you had enough power to get to that repeater. That would really be something, wouldn't it? That's awesome. Yeah. Andy, thank you. Thank you very, very much. Folks, we're going to close the show here. I did want to make it really about Greyline today. And if you have any questions, I invite you to please put them in the description section. I'll do my best to get back to you on it. Greyline is such an important time. It really is. The equator gets most of the fun. They really do because they get the most sunlight, whether it be fall or winter or spring or summer, they get the most, right? But here in the north or maybe down in Australia in the south, you can still work Greyline to your advantage. Just keep an eye on your MUF. That's the key. The MUF is the key. It'll work every time. Okay. And Anton, thank you very, very much. I appreciate that. We'll share this link to this part where I can find it. Thank you. That's very kind of you. Thank you. Folks, we're going to close the show. I'm going to thank you for coming, and I appreciate you being here. I don't ask for subscriptions. I thank that you watched, okay? I'm going to show you a final little thing here, and hopefully you enjoy it. It is our sign-off for today, and it will come from the state of New York. I hope you enjoy it. Before we close, from my buddy that just got his furnace fixed up in Canada where he needed it fixed for sure. A friend was driving on a remote section of Ontario Highway one night when he heard a call on his 2-meter radio. It was the ISS, blew his mind. He has the QSL card to prove it and some jealous friends. Last night, the ISS was going overhead, okay? And it's cold out. It was like 26 degrees. And I go out and I did. I put my pants on quick and went out there. I had a light coat on, and I'm looking. I'm searching the sky, and I couldn't find it. I was like, oh, man, doggone it. Thought I missed that. Anyway, Paul Camish, welcome. It's nice to have you. Mike 7, X-Ray India X-Ray. Love the show. I learn something new every time I tune in. Thank you, Paul. I appreciate that. That's something that's really important to me. and I do appreciate very, very much. Bob White, first time. Welcome, Bob. Welcome to the show. That's Whiskey Oscar 3 Bravo. Hi, Bob. Happy Thursday to you. It's an honor to have you here. Thank you. And Kim, thank you. Kilo 04, India Pup, India. Great topic and exceptional explanation, especially for us newbies, Larry. Now, just remember, MUF, and remember, sunrise, no delayer. You're going to work west, okay? Sunset, okay? It's a little bit weird because sunset, that delayer is still there, right? But the MUFs make a big difference. You can make amazing calls, even on 10 meters at sunset. Thanks for watching, everybody. From around the world, it's been a true honor for me to spend time with you. From the shack, Kilo 7 until November, I invite you to please get your ham radio license. You can do it. You really can. Don't make the test the reason you don't, and don't make Morse code the excuse you can't. Many countries don't have Morse code as part of their requirement to get your ham license. Contact someone like the American Radio Relay League at www.arrl.org. Hit the contact us bar. They're going to send you a ham radio club in your email that will help you get licensed. They'll get you to know them, right? They'll help you pass your test. And once you pass that test, then you really learn ham radio. www.arrl.org. Until we meet again, wherever you may be, God bless you. Thank you for watching Ham Radio Live. Bye, everybody. Cut two. We'll go to Philly. Here you go.
News Radio for the Delaware Valley. Now leaving the air for technical adjustments and maintenance of our transmitter. KYW News Radio is owned and operated by Group W Radio Incorporated, Westinghouse Broadcasting, and transmits on an assigned frequency of 1060 kilohertz with an authorized power of 50,000 watts. Our studios and offices are located on Independence Mall in Philadelphia. The staff of KYW News Radio wishes all of you a pleasant good night from the birthplace of our nation. And now, our national anthem.